I can't stop dreaming about ya, dreaming about ya. I'm alone in my room.
Yeah, I took a lot, yo.
I can't stop dreaming about ya.
Bye, your sweet princess Silke.
And every time I do what I need to do, I can't stop dreaming about ya.
Around the sun, I warm to you. Your tongue is a great persuader. Yeah, you got me sold. When I'm alone in my room, just watching our rows, I dream about you. I dream about you.
When I'm alone.
Ciao, ciao! Here I am, your sweet, super sweet, silky, soft, smooth Princess Silke, intelligent. I am sharing my wisdom with you and my generosity. You ask about Robert Parente. Robert, that's how he liked to call himself. French, because his mother's French, his father Italian. He said that he was born in Africa. Remember, the premise is I am bored. Now I am in Cuernavaca. I had been living in Mexico City, I had been living in France, and of course I am from Germany. And now, after leaving the university, actually I was just about to finish my studies. I was still studying. So young, but not young. Old in character and spirits. But tiny little people, not interesting. And now I am in Cuernavaca doing the foundation. And they are old? Old and not interesting, and I'm bored. I am not stimulated intellectually anywhere I go. I cannot share myself with anybody because I'm just bored. I was tired of Mexico like many years before I left. I mean, Mexico is kind of cool, but who is there for me to converse with? Yeah, Waltraud, my best friend from Austria, Salzburg, by the way, she never was really there for me much to talk. A little bit, but not enough. And then she left. And all my friends, yeah, if there is such a thing, like Elena, for example, who could have been a friend, she left. She was interesting. I just perceive those things. There is intelligence. And we don't need to talk about anything to know that there is intelligence. It is just the way we perceive the world and we will adjust to it or relate to it or don't relate to it. And I was lonely. So here I am in the Amigos de la Música matinee from Sunday. Amigos de la Música, Friends of the Music, organized these seasonal classical music concerts. Purely classical music, and seasonal means in that term right after summer, the all year long until before the next summer. And that was about one concert a month with a few exceptions, because all the concerts we could purchase, of course, our tickets we could go and listen to were foreigners. There was not one national playing in those concerts. So the exception would be Carlos Prieto's quartet with Carlos Prieto, the cellist, his son, Carlos Miguel Prieto, on the violin, his brother and his brother's son. So the cousins, that's the quartet. And they were national, so they would make special concerts for them. Foreigners would come, would play once and then return. Very soon as I arrived in Cuernavaca, Shigeko, the director who organized everything, she would invite me. She would invite me to the cocktails after the concert. when there was one, right? I don't know why, because she liked me, because I helped her. I'm very great at public relations and I speak languages, and she's old and they're all old and I'm young, and the young musicians, they had a good time to have somebody to relate to, which was me. I was basically hosting them, attending them, talking with them. You had Germans, Austrians. Well, Adrian Justus is Mexican, but he lived in a foreign country. He lived in Israel. His parents lived in Mexico City. So mainly there were these cocktails, and so the sponsors, La Mesa Directiva, the directors of Amigos de la Música, could visit and could meet the stars. That's kind of something which is habitual in the music scene. No, I was not part of Amigos de la Música. I wasn't sponsoring anything. Why would I? I don't have money. So here I am in one of those cocktails. I think that was the dumb mezzo-soprano, by the way, who was there. See, they sing wrong and they're obnoxious too. But I was very, very stuffed with people, cocktail. Many people was there, and we were like standing, and I walked through and I see someone coming in, like the diva of the party. And I was a man, and he was in his 50s. That was Mark Parente. He looked also very gay and smiling, like he was the center of the show. Accoutrement, no. Grabbing out for compliments. I mean, literally, he was like thirsty of acknowledgement. A little cunt. Honestly, that was my first impression. A socialite. He was there never before. That was the first time. I looked at it and I kind of smiled too, because it was kind of hilarious and ridiculous in a way. And that is what I remember. And next thing I remember, that next day, I was sitting in his garden with Chikeko and other people on one of those benches which were like posed next to the pool, which nobody ever used, by the way. In one of the fanciest old Cuernavaca neighborhoods. Which were, again, stuffed with houses, but not that convenient, all of them. His was not very convenient, but it was recognized by the society as chic and fine. And because the house was not really that great, it was like small, but it was also like many stories. So a tiny kitchen, a super tiny living room. No, a super tiny dining room, a living room regular size, then stairs down, a tiny bit of a patio to host like two of those chaises for the swimming pool, and then outdoors on a barranca, a hillside, so to speak, which had a little river down below. And I'll tell you a lot about it later, because the river smelled bad. Not the day I went there, but sometimes it would smell bad, and Mark opened a hotel which he built underneath, despite and regardless that the river would smell. In other words, he would go for the stardom of the comfort of knowing that he is in a great neighborhood, rather than finding something which would be comfortable for people. It was outrageous. Yeah, they have like a screw wrongly tied into their brains. Yeah, what that to do with Robert, princess? Yeah, what does that has to do with Robert? Okay, so there I met Mark. That was, maybe a Saturday in the evening. And he invited me. I think he invited Chigeko for public relation, or so I would go. I don't know how that came along. Often we were invited together. I don't know, people saw us kind of related in a way to the music. So he invited me and Chigeko to his house and other people. I don't know for what. I don't think we ate that day. I don't remember that. That's what he would do. He would invite people, socialite, create little, alliances. And there's other things I could see. he was constructing that hotel, yeah, with 8 rooms, tiny one. Cuernavaca is small. And he did not have permits, but he did it anyhow. But what he would do, he would invite 2 people from the government, the ones who needed to give him the permits. He would invite them socially. So, like Italian as he was, finding ways to bribe himself to get eventually those permits, but also to show off to those government agents that he is cool and that he is international, that he has class. And by the way, he also wanted to become a consul, Italian consul. And so I was part of his little scheme. I fit so very well the bill of him being a personality of class and prestige, because look at me. Yeah, I should have charged them for my presence, but well. Oh yeah, those would come often, and they would sit there, apart from the rest, on a table. And when it was time for lunch, they would exit and we would go eat. Yeah, you don't know, man, what those are capable of. The strategies, those Haynes, man. Those socialites like Mark. I met his wife, of course, she was Mexican, Jewish. She was like nada de nada, nothing, meaning she had no body forms. It was like a little stick, un palito, with short hair. I could not understand, because Mark was kind of good looking, but no, I don't think he was gay at all. Why is he marrying this little stick of a woman? Well, at the time I never knew. Later, because her father had money, and he needed that money to make his businesses. Yeah. Imagine, that's a social head whore, Mark. Totally uninteresting. No, his living room was really cute. Very simple. Could have been my living room at the time. Just white walls and plenty of books, also art books. I have no clue who read them. Maybe his brother decorated his living room. Although it did not look like his brother's style. So his brother, an architect, he had style. But let me rephrase it, right? So we're sitting now outdoors on those benches. I sit on one and Chigeko sits next to me. And other people are there. I don't know anybody of the people who sits there. And there were American people. And there was this fat, overweight, fake blonde woman. Maybe she was also in her 50s. Or maybe she was in her 40s, but she did not take good care of herself. So much dumb fast food. I don't know, I didn't look at her factions, but could have been that she smoked too, or maybe she didn't, but not nice, not pleasant to look at. Yeah, who spent maybe amounts of time in a salon, but has no clue how to actually handle herself elegantly. So in a way, she looked vulgar. So, and this woman, she approaches me, and she says to me, "Oh, you're very pretty, you're very pretty." And then she walks away. Now, at the time, I didn't understand what it all meant, but I can tell you now. So that was Parente's wife, who knew that I would be the next one he would abort, because that's what he would do. He would abort women, use them, and then drop them. So she could clearly see I would be the next one. I hadn't even met him yet. I had no clue. Well, they had somehow an agreement, or maybe not. That was the only time I saw her. And I don't know why she came to visit Cuernavaca. Because they didn't really have a relationship, and I believe him, but look at that. They lived in that Miami apartment, which was very large. So large, she said, that we don't really bump into each other. We never see each other. It helped him to pursue his business. I mentioned the whoring about it, right? I would never do that. Yeah, because people know that he lives in these towers in Miami. That was like a cool thing. In the view of the socialites again, to create commercial alliances, which was what he was doing. So she approached me, "You're pretty." She walked away, and suddenly, well, it was lunchtime. No, that was the same day. But she wasn't there anymore. Most of the people were not there. So now we were sitting in the minuscule dining patio. It's Cuernavaca, it's always warm, it's not really closed. It's like a room, but there's not like windows. It's like the opening you can watch over the greens. So we would eat. every time it would be the same. It would be some fried chicken and a salad, green salad, and maybe a tiny bit of pasta. A European way or Mexican way, not Italian way. Because I think it would come all together, if I remember well. And in the beginning, we would have these like flatbreads. It would be toasted with za'atar. That's something she did, his wife, Mark's wife. So we would like crunching. It's like tortilla chips, but in not tortillas. It's flatbread. It was really yummy. And maybe one or max two glasses of wine with the food. And that's it. There were no alcohol involved. Yeah, we would be served like maybe lemonades before. That's that. Every time it was the same food. It was good. There's no imagination about it though. But it wasn't about inviting people for lunch. It was about creating alliances and public relations. So it didn't mean anything to them. I don't think they were good hosts. Were they waiters? Maybe. Maybe that first day there were waiters because there were many people to serve lemonade. Yeah, because I don't think she or he would do that. But otherwise, I don't know, I don't remember having seen waiters. Maybe the maid came and served us some refreshment. So here we are now sitting and eating. And maybe finishing eating. And there I met Robert. He was sitting right there at the table. And he approaches me verbally, talks something to me. I have no clue what. It was almost like offensive. And he was kind of, it was almost rude in his negativity. And what I saw is an old negative fart with like ash gray skin. Yeah, overweight. Although those bodies, you don't really see overweight because you think about something different. When you think overweight, you think like fat and... But that's not the way. Those bodies are like, yeah, I don't know. It doesn't look overweight per se. But he was old, 50 something maybe. But he was old because his negativity had also marked his face. Not his brother's mark. His brother was older than he. He did not have any of this like a wrinkled face. No, Mark had a clear skin. Because Mark was outward-oriented, he was outgoing. He would engage with the world in a way which, come look at me, he said to the world. So he had to have this look at me clear view in his face, because he needed all that. And Robert was the opposite. He said the world is shit and nobody understands anything. And I don't know what else he said. He was more inward-oriented. Who turned it around in business to talk with other people like, hey, ciao, hello. Like, oh, I'm so cool, I'm Italian. Because he kind of understood that people like that. A way of engaging, and I'm different. And that's what they did. We're both different. We're Italians, now we live in America. And we are cool. We are the cool people here because we are also elegant, they said. And that came later, that they know how to behave. Yeah, well, that's what they said. So Robert approaches me verbally at that table and starts talking to me. But like I said, it was almost like, ah, you're too pretty and I'm too old, you're never going to talk to me. Something like that. But I don't know what words he used. I have no clue what he actually said. So here is an old fart, wrinkled, ugh, and I'm tired in Cuernavaca. Yeah, I looked and I did not say, what can I say? I don't talk. Particularly not, that sounds like what he was doing in German. It's called anmachen. And anmache is like, how do you even say it? In German, it's like a way of hitting on someone in negative ways without you noticing it, in a kind of sadomasochistic way, and brutal and violent in a way too. And in Hamburg, where I come from, it's vulgar. So I didn't know it was anmache. It was just weird. Why is he even talking to me if he's so negative? And it seems like he doesn't like me. And that's how he talked to me, like challenging. Which is, by the way, the same description I could give you from the man with whom I briefly worked before exiting Mexico for good. Yeah, the guy with the house which wasn't finished yet, which he showed me the night before I left. And yeah, who called me at 4 a.m. now frequently because he was drunk, he was lonely. And I had become a kind of a friend in a way. Because he approached me in the same manner. like negative is I responded to an ad in the new in the papers because I needed a job. I needed the same. Like he said, like, wow, yeah, right. You know, you like the diva. And how come you're gonna work with me doing little sales from some little shit advertisements? Hello. Yeah, well, like, okay, move on. Barbie doll, I'm busy. That's like the attitude he had. And I look at him, well, yes, I am here, serious. So he noticed, same negativity, weird, right? No, Palente, Robert was not an alcoholic. He didn't read, okay, so he had like a little limit. He would offer one bottle of wine with food and never more. He maybe said it once because he said it's so easy to just continue drinking and get, you know, he didn't say it, get addicted to it or get the habit, and that's not a good way to live. Something he said it like in maybe no phrases, but that's what he made clear. So he would share one bottle of wine with the food and never any other alcohol ever. In no part of the day, at no time. That is a healthy living. That's a good way. No, he wasn't smoking either. And those people, they don't do drugs. They are too elegant, too fine to do drugs. And yeah, in a way, they are too elegant. So I could have stopped right there, the Robert Palente story, if he wouldn't have. I don't know, maybe Mark gave him my phone number. I don't remember how it came along, but next thing I know, he calls me, maybe next day, invites me to an offer. Yeah, he made me an offer I couldn't refuse. That's how he came. What is the offer I couldn't refuse? Well, I am an aspiring opera star, and there is only a handful of opera singers which are noteworthy on earth in all times. And that was one who was still alive, and she would come one night only, in that very week, on the following Friday, to Mexico. And he was inviting me now to Bellas Artes to go watch the concert. How could I say no to that? So here is what you need to understand about the socialites. Socialites are people who live and give everything upon what other people think of them. Meeting in certain special gatherings dignified to the type of society they wish to belong. In other words, connecting, yeah, colinding with other people without really connecting in social settings, which is informal, exceeding the business relations. Okay, business relations, you have to be social. And it's pure business. So you might be nice and friendly to other people in order to achieve business. But socialites, their business is themselves. In other words, socialites like Mark, the only thing he ever does is gain his personal self-worth and recognition in terms of the people in society, in that social gathering or these social events. They give him approval. That's a socialite. He is now somebody because other people applaud him or look even up to him. It's a whore. That's what that is. Because there is no intimacy going on. Intimacy in human affairs and connection. So that was Mark. And Robert, he was a womanizer. He married by convenience an American girl, got his whatever visa. Her father had money, I don't know if he benefited from it though. So he had not enough self-esteem with all the great achievements he had. He was a social, political philosopher in so very many senses, but he did study it. Yeah, he studied those. Because that was his leisure time, because he's interested in it. His intellect so vast. We don't really read books, we study them. That means we think about them, we remember what it is. It is not for entertainment. But he studied architecture, he was an architect. And I think he was great. Because he showed me something he made. He was creative. He had a sense of style beyond a veil. I'd never seen anybody like him. He had not enough self-esteem to validate himself with that. He ran around like he had money. I think they did. Owning here and owning there. Yeah, that is money. They had whatever company they had and other businesses. And they wanted to be fine and elegant, so they went to, you know, I'd say the usual type of kind of restaurants where you have wine with your food. Mark was not a womanizer. He just needed the applause. Yeah, most likely because his father-in-law had put a lot of money into the investment he had asked him for. Mark had asked him for. And now he stayed faithful to somebody who was right there and had given him a son. Mark had a small son. He was maybe 3 or 4 or 5, I don't know. A son who Mark had no interest in. Because the son stole the scene from him. He needed to be the queen. Okay. So Robert, in opposing to it, he would be maybe silent, quiet, and target one woman at a time, whom he then would walk to his house, yeah, have intercourse or semi-intercourse, asking for sexual, you know, pleasantries, for which he would then complain that he felt like shy about it because he was also Jewish and Catholic. And then he would deem them as stupid and would drop them. Because every woman is stupid when you read Nietzsche and Kant and Brecht, and when you understand about Zarathustra, and when you understand about Gnosticism. And see, I don't need to bore you guys, my people, but he was interested, and we are too, mine and mine, we are very interested in those subjects. Because it's the essence of God. In a way, Robert was living in the essence of God, intellectually though, and very lonely. He told me once that his nephews were taken out of high school for one entire year by his cousin. And his cousin, their father, taught them philosophy. And he said, and now, as I watched them in Miami riding motor scooters, and now, he said, Robert, now they don't belong anymore here. They belong nowhere. Because suddenly the world opens and your mind starts working and your heart starts longing. And Saudade comes in and the poetry of whatever centuries that was. And it's just so unbearable to live life without it. So they kind of couldn't fit anymore. And that means Robert got it because he was describing himself not fitting anywhere. So Robert was the intellectual and Mark was the cunt. Oh, we became friends with Mark in a way, you know, in a way. I think I was their only friend ever. Because I am not a cunt, I'm not a whore, and I don't give a shit about what you do. Not even when you want to, yeah, hacer ridículo de ti mismo. When you want to be like, I don't know, when you're mocking yourself in a society like Mark did. It's like outrageous. Why would you downsize yourself like that? Increpid, decrepit, what the heck, Mark? And I laughed at him. From the inside, the moment I saw him, the first thing I said, what is that? That's kind of weird. Because I can see right through him, and maybe people didn't. Maybe he didn't saw her through himself, I'm not sure. See, well, this is the type of people I'm dealing with, who, of course, in Italian, their last name is Parente, and they said they changed it in Spanish, in Mexico, to Pariente, because people could relate to it. I mean, business. So here I am now, arriving on Friday. No, I'm just talking, I'm on floor. I just made a little dash explaining the situation. Remember, Robert made me an offer I couldn't refuse to go watch that very amazing mezzo-soprano star at Bellas Artes. So he sighted me at Sunburns next to Bellas Artes, which is a family place, which has some kind of historic value of Mexican culture. He sighted me there in that kind of cafeteria. Very large, very tall ceilings and plenty of tiles and artisanal and are very antique too. It seems like you're living in a different time, like 100 years before, without any kitsch to it, edit, you know, just like that. So he said it's me there before, and I arrive late, and I only so know, not that I give it down. I never really thought about it this way. I don't give it down. I come driving on a Friday evening all the way from Cuernavaca in through the city. You know what that means? It's really hard to know. Remember, you can cross the city in 20 minutes or in 3.5 hours. You never know on a Friday what you come up with, man. I mean, you never know. At 7 a.m., you know exactly what you come up with. Because people go to work, but on Fridays, people go, I don't know, party. I don't know, drinking or meeting their friends, their buddies or not, or going to show. I don't know. You never know what you're going to find. No, I left plenty of time early, but maybe just, I mean, I'm busy. I'm a working person. I was studying and working. So I didn't give a damn. Yeah, why does it matter? Because I remember when I met Jackie, that was a business meeting, and I was very out of my mind that I would arrive late to the meeting. Yeah, this boss, he caught me. I don't know, he just caught me. I don't know why he caught me, but he just caught me at, right on time, like 6:35, I think it was. And I said, I'm out of my mind. The Nana's not coming. I don't know what to do. I have a business meeting with an American person. And I'm, oh my God. And he looked at, he looked at me. He looked at the circumstance and he says, yeah, why don't you take the kids with you? Wow, great idea. Because I'd never done that before. So the kids had sleeping time. Yeah, they would go to bed at 6, they were small. So I grabbed them, very sleepy, put them to sleep in the car, and then I arrived, yeah, at 7 sharp, I mean, on time to my business meeting. It was like 15 minutes away. But I remember that I was worried about being on time for that business meeting with the American. But I wasn't worried at all being on time for Robert Parente. And I only remember that I was late because he claimed. I arrived to our first meeting, and the first thing he says, you are late. What the fuck? Where's your elegance, asshole? I didn't give a shit what he said. I just look at him. Okay, more negativity, right? But, well, it could be worse, negativity. Not that he, or what? Was he, like, anxiety swallowing if I might not have arrived to see the old fart? Which, suddenly, as I looked, as I sat down, now I elevated my gaze. I looked at his face. I said, who did I saw? Matching green eyes to his matching shirt. It looked amazing. His skin had flattened and was glowing in pink, not more darkish gray as I described earlier. His outfit was Italian, suitable to elegance. Yeah, he could be a model. And suddenly he was handsome. But he was smiling from the inside out. He was so excited. I have that effect on people. Remember Rachel? She too, she looked just like it. Now she was in love at our first meeting. Rachel, I'm not a lesbian. Move on. Come on, wake up. So here was Robert sitting, all excited. And he had lost 25 years? Because he was looking at me. And I did not have any more negativity from him. Ever again. Last night I dreamt that somebody loved me. No hope, no harm, just another false alarm. Last night I felt real arms around me. No hope, no harm, just another false alarm. So tell me how long.